Purim is one of the holidays in the Jewish calendar that has tremendous reverberations on a historical basis. One of the most fascinating expressions of Purim, I think, is in a discovery that was made in the 20th century of a time capsule, a synagogue that had been buried since the year 256 and suddenly rendered a tremendous amount of data about the way in which Jews saw themselves in the world around them. I'm speaking, of course, about a very famous synagogue in the city of Dura, Europos, which is located in eastern Syria on the Euphrates River. And the story is basically like this. This is a city that had a wall around it, and it was kind of in a borderland territory between the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire. And at one point in the 3rd century, the Romans were correctly fearing a Sasanian advance on the city, and so they decided to put some plans in place to protect themselves against the Persians. They ordered all of the inhabitants along the western wall of this particular settlement, the other side of the Euphrates, to abandon their homes and their businesses, and then they filled in those locations with sand. The idea being that they thought the Persians would not attack from the riverside, they would attack from the land side in the west, and so they built up a massive rampart to protect the wall, and it was to no avail because the Persians end up sacking the city, and it then was left abandoned for several centuries until it was discovered again in the 20th century and excavated in the 1930s. Now, why do we care so much about this? Because on that western wall, facing Jerusalem, of course, was a synagogue. Wow. And that synagogue was so well preserved by all the sand that was buried there that when they excavated it, they found this incredible wealth of wall paintings. And scholars have spent, you know, their entire scholarly lives studying these paintings, trying to understand what they mean for the history of the Jews in this part of the world. So let's have a look at some of them. Here's one. You can just see how gorgeous the artwork is. Very, Byzantine kind of style with sort of rigid postures and almond-shaped eyes and things like this. This is Samuel anointing David, right? A scene from the book of Samuel. Here's a beautiful rendition. On the bottom, we have something like the Beis HaMikdash. And on the top, you see it appears to be Moshe, or could be Aaron, on the right there holding his staff over the waters as the Egyptians are drowning in them. The water is closing. There's even some hands at the top that look strangely divine. It's worth mentioning, by the way, that historically, Jews were typically aniconic. They did not like representing any kind of living thing, animals, birds, or especially humans, and certainly not God. However, here in Dura Europos, we seem to have some significant exceptions to that rule. We know that Jews painted their synagogue walls, but we have very, very few surviving examples. It's only because Dura Europos was, you know, encased in sand, protected from the elements, and protected from later destruction and rebuilding that we have these things. Here's a really powerful vision of the Chet Egel, the sin of the golden calf. But what I really want to get to is this remarkable wall painting that appears to be from the Book of Esther. Let's look at it in a little bit more detail. So on the right, you see what appears to be Queen Esther, and she has, you know, women in waiting beside her, and that would be Ahasuerus on the throne, who is receiving a letter from a messenger, right? That's a really important theme in the entire Book of Purim, is messages going back and forth and crossed messages and things like that. And then on the left appears to be the scene of Mordechai being paraded throughout town in glorious honor on a horse like that, and that man leading him appears to be Haman. And Haman does not especially seem to be very happy about his situation. Of course, that's the plot of the story. And maybe he's especially unhappy because someone took away his pants. I don't know. But that's, you know, you get the, well, anyways. And then in the center, these fascinating four characters. Notice how the outside characters have their faces represented. The characters in the middle, however, have their faces partially or totally obliterated. And I really wonder what that means. Apparently there are some other examples of the eyes being graffitied out of some of these images, which appears to be an intentional thing, but it's really hard to say. I like to think that maybe that obliterated face alludes to the hidden nature of the book of Esther, but we'll have to leave that as a mystery. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this very quick talk about one historical representation of Purim. Thank you very much for watching.